Maybe focusing on YouTube. For those who are new, this is my social media coordinates. What did we do so far in this, I guess, series? So part one was getting started with Docker. So we built from ground up the application which I'm using for this talk. Part two was about using Docker Compose, which is code and provided by Docker to stitch the multiple containers together. And today we'll be looking at the orchestration, container orchestration using Kubernetes. We'll be using Minikube, which is a version of Kubernetes, which gives you a flexibility or ability to work with same set of objects that Kubernetes has on a single node cluster. So on your personal laptop, you can install this tool and you'll be able to do everything that you could do in a cluster locally on your laptop. I suggest this approach because it gives you a lot more confidence before going directly to cloud or even to physical cluster and then trying to figure out if something goes wrong, what will happen. So this is how I started Kubernetes, learning Kubernetes, and then I went to Azure. So this is the approach I suggest to others as well to start learning about Kubernetes. And then the remaining three parts will be doing deployment of AKS service, which is the managed Kubernetes service in Azure, in part four. We will extend today's stuff into more scalable features in part four. And then part five, we'll be looking at debugging and monitoring. And in the part six, we'll be doing CI/CD. Bonus session. So this is what the application we have so far. It's a small tech talks application, a list that shows like tech talks. It has a created screen. We're using ASP.NET MVC code as a front end, .NET Core as a backend API, and SQL Server 2017 on Linux, all running inside our containers. So this is what I mentioned just now. What we did in part one, that was the Docker getting started, part two was Docker Compose, and we started Kubernetes. So let's understand what is the need for orchestration. Why do we need something like Kubernetes? First thing is to deploy multiple container apps. Nowadays, you would have heard a lot about microservices, doing modular applications, deploying to multiple clouds, and this is where a tool which helps you to deploy these kind of container really helps. And that's where tools like Kubernetes, Docker Swarm, your Mesos, they really shine in this area. The next one is to scale the containerized apps. So you have the ability where you can dynamically scale based on the load. You can define like different thresholds on the resource usage, on the number of requests, and you can deploy extended containers. So you can start with, let's say, two instances, and when the load increases, you can make it five. When the load decreases again, you can scale it down. You can have new rollouts of the versions without having downtime. So you can do like a rolling update. If you have, let's say, five instances of a container running, you can have a policy in place which says update two at a time. So you still have the version one running while you are deploying version two, and then when all the five instances are updated, the older version would be discarded. It also gives you networking, service discovery, and storage capabilities. So we'll be seeing this in today's demo. We also have the flexibility of managing multiple resources across multiple containers. So what this means is I can define things like resource limit. So let's say I have a cluster with three nodes. I can say that a particular container, let's say a database container, it needs 2 GB of RAM to start with. So I can put this kind of constraint saying, in order to schedule this container, I need 2 GB of available RAM or memory on a particular node. So Kubernetes or the container orchestration tool will figure out which node has this capacity, and if there is no capacity, we will not be able to schedule these containers. So it has this kind of intelligence built in. And also self-healing. So we can again define in terms of policies what should happen. Let's say your container dies. due to some reason out of memory or some sort of crash happens, it can restart itself. So we have resilience built in into the applications, and all this comes in with the help of orchestration tool. So in the market right now, Kubernetes is the most popular one. Almost every cloud vendor has support for Kubernetes. It was a project which came out of Google. So Google was already using this for a long, long time, and they open sourced it some time back. There is one provided by Docker itself, Docker Swarm, and there is Mesos as well. So you can pick and choose which one you want, but in my opinion, Kubernetes has the advantage, and it is supported by almost every cloud, and it is quite used extensively in the market as well. So let's start with Minikube and see what we need. So as I said, Minikube is the scaled down version. It gives you same set of capabilities of a full-fledged Kubernetes cluster, but on a single node. So we can see which version of Minikube I'm running. I shared in the meetup how to install Kubernetes CLI, kubectl, as well as Minikube. So you can have a look at that. So I have 0.28 version of Minikube, and for kubectl, which is the command line tool for Kubernetes. I have 1.9 version. So Minikube starts its own cluster. It creates a VM, and it creates inside that VM a single node cluster. I have already started this, but it takes some time, about 5 minutes to get started. So I have started the Minikube cluster, but it's as simple as saying Minikube and start. I can check the status. It's already running. If it's not running, I can do a Minikube start, and it could start the cluster. I can do stop. I can delete the whole VM if I need to reclaim the space. Minikube has support for multiple versions of Kubernetes. So you can go and check which are the versions in the current version of Minikube supported. You can see here, it's like about 15 to 20 different versions of Kubernetes which it supports. So by default, it will start with version 1.10, which is the latest one. But if I want to experiment, or if I want to work with the older version of Kubernetes, I can still go back and work with these versions. Then when it comes to kubectl or Kubernetes itself, this is the command line tool which is used to work with Kubernetes. And I can check which are the configurations. So Kubernetes needs a context to work with. I can work with multiple clusters at the same time. So if I do kubectl config and get all the context that I have on my machine, here I've got 6 different contexts, but the one with the star, which is Minikube, is the current context that I will be using for this session. Okay, so what is Kubernetes? Kubernetes in general is like, it's an open source system for automating deployment, scaling, and management of containerized applications across a cluster of nodes. Point note here is it's the management of containerized application. It's not managing the cluster as such. It's really a tool which helps you to manage the application which run on the cluster. So if you have a cluster, you would still need the regular management tools of the cluster. But to manage the applications on that cluster, you would use Kubernetes. So it's like a deployment tool. It's not for managing the cluster itself, but what gets deployed on top of the Kubernetes cluster. It has a set of basic objects. So we have things like namespaces, pods, volumes, services. So namespace is like in Java or in .NET or any programming language, you have a logical location. So we can build namespaces within a physical cluster. We can have a namespace for development, we can have a namespace for QA, we can have a namespace for UAT. So it allows you to create these virtual kind of segregation of objects. So on the same cluster, Kubernetes physical cluster, you can have multiple namespaces and you can deploy same version of the application into different namespaces. Or you can have different version of your application in each of these namespaces. Pod, it's the simplest unit of deployment. So pod ideally maps to your container. In general, as a best practice, you have one container per pod, but it does support multiple containers in the same pod as well. Volume, it's a way in which you manage the state of the data for your files. If you want to manage, let's say, database objects or database files, or even if it's a batch process that you're running which creates a set of CSV files inside the container and you want it to be accessed outside once the container is stopped or once you want to upgrade the container. If you need some stateful processing and if you need to process those files, you use volumes. So it's like a map drive. That's how we map between container and your physical volumes. Service, we will see service in action shortly. And these are like basic objects, low-level objects. On top of this, Kubernetes provides controllers, which are like higher-level API. So this is what helps you in creating replica sets where you want to have more than one replica or multiple replicas of the containers. Deployment, which helps you to define a template for deploying your applications. Stateful set is when you want to deal with stateful data, state basically. So this comes handy when you want to deploy container and mainly database containers. And you want that the database containers have a stateful persistence. Daemon set, it's like daemon running on your normal, let's say, Unix boxes. So if you want to collect, let's say, metrics from each of these containers which are running, you can define a daemon set and that will be used for collecting additional information about the container. So it's like a daemon running on your physical box, but daemon set is running inside the container. So pod, it's the simplest object of deployment, as I said. It has various things associated with it. First one is the IP. So when you deploy a container inside Kubernetes, it creates its own IP for each and every pod. It can be a group of containers, but in general, it's only one container per pod. That's like the best practice, which is recommended. It contains specification how to run container along with its resources. So in this example here, we've got four different variants of pod. One, which is just like the first one, pod one, it's just a container. Pod two has container as well as volume attached to it. Third one is multiple containers and volume. And fourth one is a combination of all these three. Next one is the deployment. So deployment is like a template file. So you, in the deployment, you define what is the desired state that you want to have for your application. You can define things like how many replicas you want to have, which version of your container image you want to deploy, what is the update strategy. As I was saying earlier, do you want to update one at a time or multiple instances of the container at a time, and various metadata associated with that. So if you look at the highlighted area here, we are defining how many replicas. So one replica here, there is a metadata which says what is the selector and the match table. We have the image information, the Docker image which should be used, which version. It also has the environment variables which are required to run this image, and ports, ports which you want to expose as part of this. So it's basically a template. So if you are using something like Chef or Puppet, it's like those recipes or things that you create in these tools. So this is how we want the target application state to look like. Let's have a quick demo of these features.
Nilesh, question. So if you configure multiple containers app in one pod, how do you isolate them with each other, like they don't share the same config or same space memory or something like that?
No, they don't. Within the same pod, they share that. So they will have the same virtual
IP. That's what, they have the same virtual IP, so within the same pod.
So the IP is for the pod, complete pod.
So you can't do like a micro segmentation inside the pod for each continuous app.
No. So let's start with creating a namespace, and to create the namespace, we will be using the command line to kubectl. I usually start with help to see what are the options which are available. So here you can see it provides you basic commands for a very beginner level, intermediate deployment commands for rollout, rolling update, scale. You also have the cluster management commands, which is to get the certificate, cluster info. You also have troubleshooting commands, describing the services, describing the objects which are deployed. And you other commands, general commands. So let's start with the namespace, which is quite simple. So I say kubectl. And for this, I will use the create command. Create again, if you go to the next level of commands, you can use help here to see what are the options you have. So I can create a cluster role, cluster binding, config map, deployment, namespace, and all this set of options. So let's go here, create namespace, and I will create namespace with a dummy namespace. So now the namespace is created. I can look for that information. Say in kubectl get all. So I have just one here. I can get the description of this. This, I don't need it, so as simple as running the kubectl delete command. So that's using
command line, but command line is not the most suitable option, and Kubernetes definitely provides us better options like most modern day tools. So we can use what is called as the manifest files, which are like YAML files which describe the same thing using YAML syntax. So if you look here, here I'm creating a namespace called AKS part 3 using API version 1. I need to define what is the kind of object I'm creating and a metadata associated with that. And then I can go back to the command line and I can say kubectl create. Instead of creating an object using the object syntax, I'll say use the file. I'll give the file name and it will create the same object for me. Later on in the demo, we'll see that instead of using single file, I can give a complete folder structure, and whatever files are defined in that particular structure, it will create all the objects. So kubectl is intelligent enough, smart enough to work with single file as well as a whole set of files, folders. So if you have, like in my case, I have here three folders under the Minikube. So I have API, the definition of manifest files for that, DB, the web, and the namespace. So I can go right at the top at the Minikube level and say apply or create, and I give the whole structure. Just say file. It will create everything in one go. I don't have to go to each folder and do create or apply these values. you usually find that when you start new, a space here, maybe one here or a typo, and these things will not work together. So it's very important that the key values, they match when you define them in these labels and wherever we are having these key values. Then we define the template, and within the template again we have a spec. We can start with the containers that we want to deploy. Since it's a collection for deployment, I can have the containers collection, but in this case I'm having only one container, which is the TechTops web, which we built in the first part. I define some of the environment variables, like this is my development environment and ASP.NET Core environment value for that. I define what is the port, container port, that I want to expose out of this image. What is the image pull policy? So here I'm specifying if not present. That means where this container is going to be deployed by Kubernetes, it will check if the same version of the image already exists. If it exists, it will not pull the image from the container registry. So this is more for the optimization purpose. You can also specify always, saying no matter what, I want to deploy the specific version and pull this version of the image always from the container registry. Restart policy is if something goes wrong with this particular container, what should happen? Should the container restart, or Kubernetes restart this container, or we want to deal with it ourselves? So I say always. If something bad happens, I want the container to restart. Then there is termination grace period, which is like how much time there should be between the restart of the container. So I'm giving 30 seconds here. So just in case there is some cleanup work to be done, I can use these 30 seconds for that. So let's see how to deploy this particular web app using the CLI. So here I have the namespace TechTalks API, DB, and web as the folders. I will create the namespace first. So kubectl create. And I can say file name. Oops. Okay, it's already created. So this is the problem we have with create. So create purely tries to create the object. It's not like a upsert kind of operation in database. If the object already exists, it will throw an error. But we can use apply in this case. So instead of creating, I can say kubectl apply, and then I give the same file name. So in this case, if it doesn't exist, it will create. If it exists, it will just skip. I used the wrong file name here, sorry. Okay, so we have the namespace. Let's go into TechTalks web. And I have the deployment and the web service definitions here. So I can use the same command here, kubectl apply, file name, and web deployment. So this is already deployed, so it remains unchanged in this case. But if it was not deployed, it would go and start that container on this single node cluster. I can get the description of this using kubectl describe. So I have the deployment and TechTalks web. The reason it's not giving me any information, because I have a namespace associated with this. So when there is a namespace associated, I need to give the namespace as well. And the namespace I'm using here is AKS part 3. Okay. So now you can see all the information about this deployment, what is the namespace it's using when it was created, what are the labels, what are the annotations, what's the selector, how many replicas does it need, desired is one, updated is one, total is one. So let's say we said we have a real cluster and we wanted five replicas, and if there is four replicas running, when we describe, we would say we would get information saying desired was five and we have four running. So this is the kind of information we can get from the description of this. So once this is deployed, how do I access this? So it's like deployment is done. You have the web site running. It's available. To access this, I need to expose a service. So for the service, we can go back and look at the service definition. So service, the kind is service here. Metadata again, each Kubernetes object will have its own metadata, and that's how we link the namespace to it. Then the spec, like for deployment, for the service also, we have a spec. There is a type. In this case, I'm using node port. There are other types, like we can use load balancer, which will provision a public IP if we are running on a cloud, or we can use, there are four different options when it comes to the type of service. The node port that I'm using is it assigns a node or a port to this service on each and every node of the cluster. So it's like, even if the service is not deployed on one particular node, let's say you have got four nodes in your cluster, you have two replicas running, so two nodes will have your service deployed. You are hitting the node three, which does not have this particular service deployed. Because of node port, it would still be able to service your request, because it knows that the same node is node port, or port is exposed on each and every node of the cluster. So this is one of the feature where you can use node port. Port is internal port that we are using from the container. So I'm mapping what the container is exposing. So if you go back to the deployment, you see here the container port is 80, which is exposed. I'm exposing the same port via the service. And then the selector. Selector is a web front deployment. So this is what I can use to query this particular service definition from outside. And this is actually what ties into the definition here. So you see here, run web front. So this is how the service links itself to the deployment. So the deployment is like physical deployment, and if you're using, let's say, IIS, you physically go and deploy the files, but you still need a way of exposing that as a URL, right? So that work in Kubernetes is done by service. So let's see how we can get the information about this particular deployment or the service. Because the port will be dynamically assigned, I can use this command to get the URL of the web. So it is dynamically assigning the port number here as 32595. If I do the deployment again, maybe the port number would be different here. But you can see that this is how it is exposing the container application, which is running inside the container. Then let's go and look at the API part. So for the API deployment, initial part is similar. We have the kind as deployment, we have the metadata, we have the replica, selector. But in case of deployment specification, I'm using a concept called as init containers here. And this is one example where we could have multiple containers within the same pod. So what the init container does is it makes sure that before your actual container, which is web API, starts, it needs some sort of dependency. So in case of my application, I have the web API communicating with SQL Server 2017, and I need to initialize the database before the API can start communicating. So I can do that initialization as part of the init container. And if you remember from the first and second talk, I was saying, just wait for the SQL client. We will use it later. This image, we were still building it that time, but it was not used anywhere. So this is where I'm using that particular image, which has a SQL client installed. And I'm installing the initialize database script there. So last time you saw me running this manually, whereas here what I'm doing is, as part of the initialization process, I run an init container which makes sure that this runs first before anything gets deployed as part of this deployment. So by running init container, I'm making sure that my database is ready before the application can start communicating with that. And then rest of the part is same. When it comes to the actual container, it's running the API, TechTalks API version. I'm passing some parameters like the database connection string. I'm exposing a different port here, and the rest of the part is same. Restart policy, termination. In terms of exposing this, there is no change. So it's exactly same to the web. So only difference is the label, the selector that it's using, which is TechTalks API here. Then let's look at the database part. So this is where I'm using a different kind of object, which is stateful set. So as I mentioned initially, this is helpful when you want to have a stateful processing, when you want to persist data and your container should have a stable state associated with that. So I'm using an object called stateful set, and it has a special service name associated with that. And the remaining part is similar. I'm not doing any changes. So in this stateful set, I'm going to instantiate the MS SQL Server Linux version, which will run. So what's basically happening here is we start three containers, one for database, one for API, one for the web. And your API container has the init container, which initializes a database inside this container. And then the application uses that. I also have the security part here where we can define a password for the SA account that I'm using. We can put it inside a manifest file. So this is helpful when we have a clear separation in terms of, you know, who owns the deployment part. And in many organizations, you have an ops team which manages the production passwords and dev team does the deployment. And we just use, you know, the secret. We don't know where the file is located, or we know where the file is located, but we don't know the content of that. So in this case, we can use, you know, a dev team can work with these passwords. We can still say that my stateful set is going to use this secret from a file using this SA password, but I don't know how that is generated. So an ops team can generate it and store it in the format here. So this is another good practice we can follow. But to keep things simple here, I'm using just a plain text password, but this is the same password I'm storing inside that file. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. So we talked about, we looked at namespaces, we looked at deployment, a little bit about the service. So service is like the stable endpoint. What do we get from a service is it provides load balancing capabilities. So if in this example, I've got, let's say, two instances of my API running, I have a replica factor of two, and it's running on node one, node two. My front-end web application can talk to it using the service discovery mechanism of Kubernetes. And it gives this TechTalks API as the service. So I don't have to really point to node one, or I don't have to point to node two. It's like the load balancer that we have in normal web servers. But this is the software defined load balancer. It also provides a stable IP. So let's say you have four or five different machines, physical nodes in your cluster. And because of the restart or because of your upgrade of the version of application, initially these two were running on node one, node two. And version 2 of the application starts running on node 3. So you don't again have to go and change the front-end application. Because it's using service discovery, it's referring to this using the services, it can still work no matter where the container is scheduled by the orchestrator. So we had a look at the stateful sets. So as I was saying, it's really useful when you are dealing with databases and you want to have stateful persistence. A good part about stateful set is even if your pod crashes or even if your cluster goes down and you have to restart the cluster, it would still be able to work with the original set of data. Okay. So let's look at the control plane. So this is like the management portal of Kubernetes. And the way I can access that is using Minikube dashboard. So this gives me information about the cluster state. So I have cluster, what are the namespaces inside that? So by default, Kubernetes creates three namespaces, default, kube public, and kube system. If you don't specify the namespace, all the objects that we create would be under the default namespace. We have the list of nodes. In our case, since it's a Minikube cluster, there is only one node called Minikube. Persistent volume, I will talk about this when we start deploying to cloud in the next version. Roles, Kubernetes has support for role-based security. So we can have a very fine-grained control over who has access to what resources. We can define that here. Storage classes, again, I would come to this in the next one. We can filter on the namespace using namespaces here. Then we can look at the workload, a complete overview of also what is deployed. So how many deployments happened, how many pods are there, how many replicas are running, how many stateful sets. I can get the information about each and every deployment, each and every pod. So all the objects that are shown, if something is happening in the cluster, I can get the information about that cluster here. I can drill down into each one of these objects and find more information about what events occurred, what time did they happen. And so forth. So all this is available. This is the same portal we will get when we run a full-fledged cluster using Kubernetes. So this is another area where I find it really useful that you can do exactly the same thing in a cluster or in a single node cluster.
Like, so this portal doesn't give the visibility of what's containerized application running inside, right? What's happening in the containerized application?
No. This is about what is, as I said, right, Kubernetes is your deployment of the containerized application. So it tells you what is the state of the Kubernetes cluster, not what is running inside that particular container. This one? No, this is what I defined in my manifest file. So this is that additional metadata that I can use. I can filter based on these labels. So let's say I have different namespaces and I want to filter on particular namespace. That's what I did here when I chose AKS part 3 as the namespace. So it's showing me only the objects related to this namespace. I can use this, the labels, for other scenarios where I have things like, okay, production cluster or UAT cluster or dev cluster. I can use this kind of metadata, and then I can filter those objects based on that metadata. So it's basically a label. And here, when it comes to pod, and as well as stateful set and the replica set, you can also see the desired and the actual count. So one of one means I requested one, and I have one running. If it is not matching, I would be able to see it here.
So you can have skill set concept?
Yes.
Desired minimum and max concept?
Yes, we can have that. This is what I was saying about the cluster IP or the node IP. So if you look at the services, Each of the service has its own internal IP, which can be accessed only via the Kubernetes resources. This is not exposed outside. So I can't access this outside of the cluster. So since one example here is the database. Database is running. You can see from the application here where I was using that. If I go back and if I hit this, this data is coming from the database, the initialization script that I ran. But I can't use a tool like SQL Management Studio to access that database because it is not exposed outside of the cluster. Only these resources, the API and the web front end, can talk to it. It's not accessible from outside. If I have, and in the next session, I will show you how we can expose this using the public IPs. And we can have these secrets, as I said. So that's another good practice where you can register secrets within the cluster and these resources can use those secrets. So this is the cluster IP. And then we have those nodes that we are exposing or the ports that we are exposing. So if you look at the web front, I was exposing 80, which is the container port. And then there is the node port because I said I want the node port to be exposed. So it's exposing this dynamic port here. I can also make it static if I want. I can say every time the container is created, I want to expose port 80 only. That's also possible. So we looked at these kubectl commands, various of them. Here are some references. So the code demo, it's available, the complete source code on GitHub. Like Docker, if you remember last time, I shared with you play.docker.com or some site which allows you to run Docker within the browser. You can do the same thing with Kubernetes. You have a Kubernetes playground, labs.playwithk8.com. I found this particular PDF very helpful. It gives a sample application with various objects that I described here. There are two other links which I really recommend that you spend some time reading, the Kubernetes theme park analogy and the illustrated children's guide. So this explains you Kubernetes in the most layman terms. So this is the, it's like telling to a kid, small kid, what Kubernetes is. And this is really illustrated that way. It's like a story. You might have seen this, but I find it really helpful, you know, when you are trying to link stuff like what is a container, what is a pod, what is a service, why do you need this, why do you need replicas, these kind of stuff. For a non-technical person, this is really, really helpful. Similarly, you have another one which is slightly better, I would say. You are not at a kid level, more at a college level, let's say, which is explaining Kubernetes on a theme park analogy. There is another analogy which I came across in one of the articles. It was about the air traffic controller or airplanes and so the author, he was equating Docker containers, individual Docker containers as airplanes, which are flying everywhere. And then you need somebody to control those planes. So that's where something like an orchestration engine like Kubernetes comes in, who can say, okay, which bay you need to go and land if there is a change in the schedule. So that's like version changes. How do you inform the customers who are going to come and land that plane? So that was another analogy which was used. So I really recommend that you go through these two links and that will really help you to understand the concepts behind Kubernetes. They really explain it very, very nicely. And then there are other links which I have. There is also the links for YouTube videos that we recorded for
Meetup page.
I will share these slides. If you want, I can put it on the meetup as well. No problem. Which one? Yes, this is the one. Okay. There is another thing which I usually do. How many of you know that PowerShell runs on almost cross-platform nowadays? Yeah, so I'm using PowerShell script. So instead of running, you know, individually all these, I have a small PowerShell script which I can share with you. So I run the same set of commands here, but using PowerShell. So this deploys the complete application for me, and it also destroys it. So I can show it to you quickly. Let me go and do a teardown of this. So this will go in the reverse order. So if I deploy web first, then the database, and then the API, it would delete those instances in the reverse order here.
Download the modules first to
execute. Yes. So done. I can then deploy the same one. Oops, some problem. Okay, it is still getting terminated, so that's why it's giving that error, but if I run it after some time, yeah, should be fine. And now if I go back to the cluster state, I should see what's happening. So you would see a difference. You can see in real time what is getting deployed, what is the state of each and every object, and you can almost follow it. So thank you. Any questions? If you can help with a feedback, that would be really good. It's like 3 or 4 questions. It would be helpful for me as well as the organizers of this meetup to improve. Yeah, I'm happy to take any questions if you have.
Could be in this way. Does this do the load balancing when you want to deploy different instances?
Different instances at the node level or at the application level?
Application level.
What do you mean by load balancing? Can you explain a little bit more?
Something like I want to scale up my application.
Mm-hmm.
So it grows up my users, right?
Yes.
So how do you do the load balancing?
Load balancing, you can define the number of replicas you saw in the manifest file. So I can say how many replicas do I start with, and then there is in the advanced features you have like monitoring of the load, so you can check what is the load on that particular application service, and then you can scale. So you can monitor, let's say, the memory usage or the processor based on the kind of applications, whether it's memory intensive or processor intensive. And then you can set thresholds saying you can monitor application metrics saying in, let's say, 1 minute, you are receiving more than 1,000 requests. Let's say you can service up to 1,000 requests with 3 or 4 replicas. But the moment it goes beyond 1,000, and if that happens for continuously 2 minutes or 3 minutes, you know that your application will not be able to handle that. So you can scale.
So it will give you this kind of monitoring?
There is limited monitoring within Kubernetes to do this, but there are other tools which are built on top of Kubernetes, which allows you to do that.
You can use Prometheus.
Prometheus, yeah.
It's more powerful.
Yeah. Multiple virtual machines? Yes. I can show it to you next time. That's the next session.
Okay. Nilesh, question.
Yeah.
like PowerShell, we have what if, then we have Terraform plan, we have native commands of Kubernetes. Instead of apply, create, apply, we have to just see what if happens.
Dry run,
is there?
It's there.
Okay.
You can do dry run.
Yeah. So it actually simulates what's happening at and whether it's really like anything, it is failing, any dependency,
yes,
it tells us.
It's possible. I haven't tried it, but I think it's there. Any other question? I have some t-shirts from Centamil. So, one. Can you catch? Okay. If it fits you, yes. If not, you have to contact Centamil. Yes, somebody had a question at the back. Yes, Istio is like next level. So when I look at these different services, right, Docker is like level 0, level 1, Docker Compose maybe level 2, Kubernetes, Docker Swarm, these deployments, I would put them level 5, level 6. And then on top of this, you still need something, that is Istio. It's really when you want to run production at scale, you need a tool like Istio.
Sorry, which
one? Istio.
How do you spell it?
I-S-T-I-O, T-I-O, Istio.
I-S-E-I-O.
I-S-T-I-O, Istio. It's a service mesh. So it works on top of Kubernetes. So it gives you the ability to define rules. It gives you the ability to define faults. You can inject faults into your services. You can really do things which is not possible using current technologies.
But I can use Cloud Foundry or something like that to do a lot of stuff on top of Kubernetes, correct?
Yeah, but what Istio provides you is a concept called a sidecar container. So it creates a container in the same node as your own application container, and then you can just with some minor configurations without changing your application code, have metrics which can go into things like Prometheus. You can have, which is the tracing, distributed tracing, all these really production grade services, right, which you would otherwise spend a lot of time configuring and monitoring. It comes built in into Istio. So you just, by means of configuration, can get this working.
I haven't heard it because normally in production, people either use like Cloud Foundry with Kubernetes, Prometheus for monitoring, because a lot of